Welcome back to JK Dentees. Today our topic is vertical jaw relation. So in my previous lectures, you have learned about horizontal jaw relation as well as the orientation jaw relation. So today we are going to learn about what is vertical jaw relation, what is the importance of recording vertical jaw relation, how we are going to record it. So basically, we will first start, what do you mean by vertical jaw relation? The amount of separation between the maxilla as well as the mandible is the vertical relation, or you can say the vertical dimension. So that is the maxilla and mandible, the separation between them is the vertical relation. So vertical relation is being divided mainly two main types, like vertical dimension at rest and vertical dimension at occlusion. So there is vertical dimension at rest and vertical dimension and occlusion. Now you will see what do you mean by rest as well as the occlusion. So vertical dimension of rest, it is the position at which the maxilla as well as the mandible, or you can say the jaw, is at the position of rest. What do you mean by a position of rest? It means the muscles are in a state of tonic equilibrium. That is, they are in a state of harmony, they are in a state of equilibrium, that is, they are not strained. That is vertical dimension at rest. Then what do you mean by vertical dimension of occlusion? It is a condition in which the teeth are touching each other. It is either the teeth, or you can say the occlusal rims, or the central bearing plates, or any stop. So that is vertical dimension of occlusion. Now we will see why it is important to record the vertical dimension. If you will not record this relation proper, there will be discomfort, there will be strain at the temporomandibular joint, and patient will not be comfortable with your prosthesis or whatever the denture you are giving to the patient. So it is very important to record it rightly. Now what will happen if you not record it properly? If it is increased or if it increased? Think about, if your vertical dimension is in increased condition, what will happen? If this is, I am giving you a denture at an increased dimension, what will happen? There will be stress all over in this area. The muscles will be in condition of stretch, which a patient don't want. Secondarily, what will happen? There can be increased facial height. It will not at all aesthetic. There can be pain in the temporomandibular joint. There can be clicking sound. So what will happen now if it is reduced? It's basic thing. There will be decrease in the vertical dimension, or you can say decrease in the lower facial height. There can be dropping of the corner of the mouth, and there can be drooling of saliva from this region. And if there is excessive collection of saliva in this region, the patient may develop angular chelitis. Again, there can be blocking of ischial tip. If there is a reduced dimension, what will happen? The ear tube may get blocked. That is, the ischial tube may get blocked. Patient will feel discomfort. There can be loss of muscle tone. There can be seen as wrinkles in the faces. There is loss of vertical dimension. So it is very important to give your patient your denture at the correct vertical dimension. So how you can do that? So first we will see the methods about vertical dimension at rest, and then we will see how to record vertical dimension at occlusion. So let's see about vertical dimension at rest. Vertical dimension at rest can be recorded with the help of facial measurements. So first point is the facial measurements. So in that, first method can be swallowing, or you can say relaxation. So what we do? We just ask the patient to relax or swallow or to do some movements like licking of the lip. In that condition, the jaw automatically goes at a state of rest. So whenever the patient is performing these movements like swallowing, then what you do, you just take an adhesive tape in a form of a triangle, and if this is your patient, and you just apply the tape at the tip of the nose as well as the tip of the chin. Okay, and when the patient is performing all these movements, you just measure this distance. So it helps in recording the facial measurement. That is the first method when the patient is performing these movements. The second method, the first is swallowing. The next is tactile sensation. So what it is? In this, we just ask the patient to open wide like this and keep the wide opening for a minute, like 1 or 2 minutes. After that, when it gets strained, patient get tired, we just ask the patient to close until he feel comfortable till that position, and we just record the measurements. So first we ask the patient to open wide, hold that position, and then close till he feels comfortable, and then we can measure it. So but the problem is that there is a patient perception in this, so there can be error in this method. Okay, so second one was tactile sensation. Then there is method called as phonetics, or you can say speech. So what we do in this, we ask the patient to say words ending at M. So it is very important. You need to ask the patient to say any word ending at M, like you can say Ram, Rahim, or any word, whatever you feel like. So as soon as it ends at M, like M, so both their lips are contacting each other. At that point, you need to measure the distance from the tip of the chin as well as the tip of the nose. So as soon as it stops at M, so I'll just measure it. So it will be the rest position, because at that position, the jaw will be at rest. Then can be their facial expressions. Like you can see the skin around the eyes, you can see the skin or the nostrils. They should be in a relaxed position. The patient should be in a relaxed breathing position. So you can notice all this like in a form of a facial expression and determine that a patient is in physiological, or you can say vertical dimension at rest. So there is expressions, or you can say facial expressions. Fourth point. Then there comes an important point, that is anatomical landmarks. So what is in the anatomical landmarks? If this is your patient, the distance from the pupil, so these are the pupils of, okay, so distance from the pupil till corner of the mouth, okay, is considered as A, or you can say rima oris, that is the corner of the mouth. And from the anterior nasal spine, that is anterior nasal spine, till the lower border of the mandible, it is considered as B. The amount that is A should be equal to B for the jaw to be in a condition of rest. That is, in a position of rest, A will be equal to B. So you can measure this with the help of Willis guide. So the guide which is used to denote this is Willis guide. So this guide helps to give you vertical dimension at rest. So what we have covered, about facial measurements, that include swallowing, tactile sensation, then come the speech, facial expressions, and the important one, that is anatomical landmarks, which includes the Willis guide. So with this we can record the vertical dimension at rest. Now we have to record the vertical dimension at occlusion. Two type of methods, that is mechanical methods as well as physiological method. The most followed one is the Nisswanger's method, Thompson's method. So what we do in this method? So similarly, in this method we do apply an adhesive tape on the tip of the nose as well as the tip of the chin. So I'll draw a patient here. Similarly, there is a patient and I have applied the adhesive tip on the tip of the nose as well as on the chin. And what we will do, I'll just place the occlusion rims inside mouth. Okay, so I have placed the rims inside the mouth and I will measure the distance between the two points, that is this. This is considered as vertical dimension of occlusion. Why vertical dimension of occlusion? Because we are placing the rims inside. Why occlusion? Because they are touching each other. As I have already explained you, video is something, a contact between the teeth or the occlusion rims. Second, what we'll do, same patient, will just keep the points same and we'll ask the patient to say words ending at M to record the vertical dimension at rest. So with that we will get a vertical dimension at rest. So we have two values, vertical dimension at rest and vertical dimension at occlusion. But before going into this method, I would like to explain you something about freeway space. So if you see inside your mouth or in the mouth, there is an amount of separation of 2 to 4 mm. Whenever you will close, the teeth will not touch each other. There is amount of separation. That separation is called as freeway space. This 2 to 4 mm of separation, it helps us to be in a comfortable position, to be in a state of tonic equilibrium, and it is state of normal. So we need to give this 2 to 4 mm of space in our denture also. That's why we need to incorporate this space while recording the vertical dimension. How we can do so? So in the Nisswanger's method, what it says, vertical dimension at rest minus vertical dimension of occlusion is equals to freeway space. So in this vertical dimension, it is a higher amount. When we minus it with the vertical dimension of occlusion, you will get the freeway space. So I have already told you freeway space must be 2 to 4 mm. So we will record the vertical dimension. For example, the vertical dimension in this condition is about 74. And occlusion is about 72. So what we will do? The difference, that is vertical dimension at rest minus vertical dimension of occlusion, is equals to like 2 mm. So it is coming in the range of 2 to 4 mm. That means your vertical dimension is correct. So this is a Nisswanger method we are using to record the vertical dimension correctly. And it is most commonly used in the clinics. But what if the value is more than 4 mm? If it is more than 4 mm, it means your vertical dimension is less. Okay? And if it is less than 2 mm, then it means your vertical dimension is more. If it is more, what you need to do? You just need to reduce the rim height to get an appropriate freeway space. And if it is more, what you need to do? You need to adjust 1 mm extra on the rim to get it correct. So this was about the Nisswanger's method. By meter, in this what happens? We are just using a central bearing plate on one rim, and in another mandibular rim we are placing. So for example, if this is my rim, then I'm placing a plate on my rim with a meter attached. So there is a gauge. When the patient closes with the highest pressure on the boost by meter, that is a condition when it is closing in centric occlusion. So highest pressure is equals to centric occlusion. So whenever you're getting a highest reading in boost biometer, it means your patient is closing in centric. Or you can say centric occlusion. So this method is used, second method, that is boost biometer, to determine vertical dimension and occlusion. These methods called as mechanical methods that include ridge relation and ridge parallelism. First, in this ridge relation, there is incisive papilla. It is considered as a landmark which is not resorbing at all, and it is maintained. It is a stable landmark. So the distance from the incisive papilla till the edge of the lower incisors is 6 mm. So if you consider the vertical overlap, it is about 2 mm. So this distance will be about 4 mm when we subtract the vertical overlap. Okay. So distance comes to be around 4 mm. So you just need to measure from the incisive papilla till the lower ridge. If it is 4 mm, you can get the correct vertical dimension. Second is ridge parallelism. So when are the ridges parallelism to each other? When it is in a state of occlusion, or we are in a state of coming in occlusion, the mandibular ridge is parallel to the maxillary ridge. So you need to ask the patient to close at a condition nearby a 5 degree opening. So the mandibular ridge will be parallel to the maxillary one, and you can get a vertical dimension at occlusion. So this was a mechanical method which include ridge parallelism as well as a distance from the incisive papilla to the lower edge of the mandibular teeth. Then there are other methods like former measurements. Like if a patient, you have a patient's photograph, old photograph, you can measure the distance with the teeth. There can be profile silhouettes. What do you mean by silhouettes? So there is a cuts of the face. For example, if there is a patient's face, there is a cardboard used to make the profile silhouettes. So there is some cardboard cuts, and you can use that cuts the patient after extraction. So there is this Silhouette's before extraction, you can use it after extraction to measure the distance, or you can say the vertical dimension. Then there are former dentures, there can be articulated cast that you can previously mount the cast when the patient was dentulous and then use that as a measurement. So these are the different methods, like mechanical methods as well as the physiological methods. So in this lecture, I have covered about what is vertical dimension, how to record it, what will happen if you not record it correctly, the vertical dimension at rest, the methods of vertical dimension at rest, vertical dimension of occlusion, the methods. I have explained you in detail about the Nisswanger method, which is the most followed one, which you will be utilizing mostly. So what happens after recording the vertical? You just move forward for recording of the horizontal jaw relation. So please don't forget to watch my video on horizontal jaw relation as well as the orientation jaw relation. I hope you have understood the topic. If you still have any doubt, feel free to ask me. Thank you so much, and don't forget to subscribe JK Dentist Academy.